Høstenfar den lokalisert bak hudalappen og vil egentlig ikke ha fått personlighetsforandringer. Typisk for svulter i bakhodet av synsforstyrrelse, men han har ikke hatt slike plager. Han klager på en kraftig hodepine, men det vanlig konsekvens av alle typer hjernesvulser og skyldes trykkøkning. Du kjent med at faren din har et alkoholproblem? Ja da, svarte Mikael i et likegyldig tonefall. Enkelt av disse symptomene kan skyldes alkoholforgiftning, fortsatte overlegen. Faren din husker ganske lite i de siste ukene og har problemer med å gjøre redde for hvor han har vært. Hukommelsestap oppstår når en sult vokser i tinnelappen. Så det også litt atypisk for hans situasjon. Jeg tror mer på at det alkoholen som har forstokket både raserianfall og dårlig hukommelse. Men hjernen vår like kompleks som universet. Svulsten forholdsvis stor og presser på hele massen. Kanskje forskyver den på all materien, slik at både pannelappen og tinninglappen skises mot innsiden av kraniet. Da vil han få et utfallssymptom. Men han bestemmer selv. Vil han at dere skal operere? Kan ikke jeg nekte? Han ønsker operasjon, og da blir det faktisk opp til meg som behandler det kirurg, og jeg utfører den. Men i slike situasjoner spør jeg alltid pårørende. Det du og jeg som må leve med valget hans. Om han dør, jeg ba faren din informere dere. Hun skulle hatt med seg et familiemedlem i dag. Ikke det at noen må signere på papiren, men jeg ville være trygg på at dere kjente til risikoen. Hun kom alene og håpet jeg hadde glemt det. Så valgte han deg i siste instans. Fortell meg detaljert hvordan dere gjør det. Jeg vil vite fra jeg eventuelt sier ja til, hva jeg eventuelt sier ja til. Han blir lagt på magen, hodet blir låst til en ramme, og håret på bakhodet blir bare bedt vekk. Jeg dissekerer meg gjennom bakved skallegrop til beinet, sårhakker, holder huden og muskulaturen til siden. Så bor jeg to hund og sagger gjennom skallen, like ved den store hudåpningen, der ryggmargen springer inn. Det tar rundt tre kvarter å komme gjennom beinet. Mikael hadde vært til stede ved flere obduksjoner. Hjernen hans mannet frem lukten og sagen skjær gjennom kraniet. Den skjærende lyden runget inn i hodet hans, og han kunne fornemme det ekle varmen mot ansiktet som friksjonen skapte. Hjernehinnen det neste jeg må forsere. Jeg er forholdsvis hard, men skapelen skjærer ut et lite utsnitt. Da vil jeg se svulsten og tæren prøve. Det syns ikke god etter deres svulster, tenkte Mikael. Heller få målet til en svulst er å ødelegge. Det er bare mer eller mindre effektive. Bestemmer vi oss for å prøve, bruker jeg skalpelen og et sug og fjerner jeg det jeg ser. Vi har et 3D-kamera som blir ført inn gjennom nesen. På bildeskjermen skillet mellom hjernemasse og svulst ganske tydelig. Men hjernen ligger I flytende væske og får flyte seg. Vi kan ikke stole på bildene. Og når man stirrer gjennom åpningen, ser det meste grått ut. Jeg vil snakke med han før jeg bestemmer meg. Legger nikket og strøk hendene over lårene, som får tørke svetten av håndflatene. William hadde blitt rispet I magen med noe skjart. Det levrede blodet hadde forseglet kuttet. Han var ikke hos politiet. Han krabbet bort til gitterporten, som var låst med hengelås og festet med kjetten til en endestubbe. En smal, dunkel gang gikk forbi cella. Kun et svart skinn strømmet inn mellom stengene. Lyset stømmer fra et enslig lys. Sjåfør, 20 meter lenge ned I korridoren. Lampene som hang I taket utenfor buret var like fargeløse og kalde som murveggene. Cella måtte være plassert under baken. Og de stadige metalliske dunkene og skingrende bremselyder var det togskinner og god trafikk over ham. Det kunne forklare hvorfor murveggene ristet så den mørkne møtelen drysset ut av sprekkene. William satt opp på veggen og trakk knærne opp mot brystet. Og det ble kaldere. Han syntes han sjalv mer og mer. Panikken over ikke å vite hvor han var, og hvorfor han var der, ødela effekten av det lille heroinet som fortsatt var igjen I kroppen. Han strøk seg over hodet. Den lille hannekammen hadde falt helt sammen. Den seige voksen rømt ned langs stigningene. Hvem hadde tilgang til en celle som dette? Det kunne ikke være en sliten junkie som hadde sett ham fikse et skudd. Og som var bestemte seg på å ramme ham. Det måtte være bakmenn, de som eide dopet. På et døgn hadde Are, Kjetil og han pumpet 3 gram heroin I egne året og solgt rundt 50 brukerdoser på gata. So there are 2 parallel stories going on here. And the book opens with, we already are in, all the way in the story. And the book starts. There is already something going on. So we meet the character that is obviously a drug user somewhere in Oslo. The first thing that we get to know about him is that somebody cares about him enough that they go to a meeting for the families of people who are addicted. The culture here in Norway is such that when people are addicted to drugs, there's always centers for the people who are affected by the ailment of others. For instance, the school, one of the schools where I work at has an office in an office building, and this office building has a series of different business businesses in there, like their law offices. There is a carpeting business in the bottom, the first floor. There are different businesses there. There is a Chinese restaurant next door. And one of the things on this building is an office where people can come in if they are family members of people who have certain ailments. And the government pays for these offices and pays people to provide this type of assistance. So, in the beginning of this book, the character is actually in a meeting. And then on the very first chapter, that's the first thing that happens, is a character going right in through the door where it says support group for affected family members or affected people. So they use the word pårørende, which means affected. And then when you think about somebody who does drugs or who is an alcoholic, there is a group of people, like the family members are affected by it. The loved ones are affected by it. There's not just the family. There can be like a girlfriend or a group of friends or co-workers who are affected by somebody's drug use or alcohol abuse. So they have a center, a place for people who are affected. A support group where they can sit together and talk about these things to other people who can relate. And I find this a very good part of the culture. I complain a lot about the cold here. I complain about a series of different things that I don't find fair. For example, a friend from Congo Kinshasa who has been living here for the past 15 years. I remember he was this brilliant man who was a doctor in Congo, Kinshasa. But when he got here, even though he had all his documentation over a decade's studies as a doctor, plus God knows how long he was working in the field, they were not allowing him to practice because he didn't pass a Norwegian test. So there's a few things that I find that I don't agree with in the system. There are certain things that I really appreciate for people to have that sort of support, the moral support they get from different groups, the government supports these groups to make sure that people have an outlet for their pain. So in the very beginning, we see this. It is the person who is walking into this. Is somebody that is a family member. And then there is somebody in this meeting talking about their kid being gone. So they're parallel stories from what I can tell so far. Hadde Are kjæreste til han pumpet 3 gram heroin i egne årer og solgte rundt 50 brukerdoser på gata. Men det de solgte, var blandet ut med Fisherman's Friend. William anslår de hadde brukt opp en fjerdedel av stoffet. Så her, the way I see it, the way this author writes, Eirik Husby Saker, where he writes, there are flashbacks, flash forwards, there are the narrative shifts focuses, like at one point we're with the family and now we're again with the person who uses drugs himself, and he's talking about heroin use and also about how he sells doses in the streets. This is part of a culture that people can't easily access, and if I hadn't read about it, if I hadn't watched the news and seen how it is, I would not ever know about any of this. It's not readily out there for everybody to access. So Eirik Husby is the author of the book Judas Kysse, The Kiss of Judas is the name of this book. Da skulle det være igjen over 200 gram av det stjålne heroinet, og de hadde ikke brukt opp pengene etter salget. Hvis han leverte tilbake spennedoppet, var det en sjanse for at bakmennene låt være å drepe han. Han ville kanskje miste et par fingre, og det ville gi han et straffebot for tyveriet og stoppe han. Og de to andre hadde ruset seg på, men de ville la han gå. Etter det han gjorde mot Kjetil, forkjente han uansett å lide. Plutselig forsvant kjæret fra det fjerne lystofferet. Han trodde først det hadde sluknet, men så skimte han omristet av et menneske som kom nedover korridoren og skygget for lyset. Skrittene kastet ekko fra de harde overflatene, og det rasslet i noe som hørtes ut som små penger. Hei, jeg blir holdt fanget. Din politi, vedkommende gikk i et bestemt hat, nesten som hun marsjerte. Og han svarte ikke på tulloppene. Viljen så ansiktet der skikkelsen kom bort til lyttere. Et barbert hode som var firkantet på grunn av det markerte skjevepartiet. Mannen var kledd i en hvit uniformskjorte og svart feltbukse med refleksstriper over anklene. Striper som skimmer som søl i det svake lyset huset. Rasslingen kom ut fra utstyret i beltet hans. Det var en av vektene på Oslo S, Freddy. Han hadde kastet ut William fra stasjonen flere ganger. Hvor er jeg? I en gammel tollcelle. Når tollene pågrep noen på toget for smugling, pleide de å sette dem her nede mens de ventet på smugling. Har jeg vært huset på Oslo S? Skal jeg liksom få en lære penge? Og jeg ikke kommer tilbake? Viljen begynte å le. Han hadde trodd det var bakmenn, at kriminelle hadde funnet ut at han hadde stjålet heroinpartiet deres. Here is one thing that I talk about when I do literary analysis, because people usually, and I think a lot of what people say is just out of ignorance, because they don't know any better. They come in here, they see me holding a book, and as I read passages from it, and the word passage, it is not just related to the Bible. I find it completely, it blows my mind how people will always, when I say passages, they automatically think it has to be something to do with the Bible. They can't have a different idea from it. When passage, excerpt, bits and pieces. I mean, there are passages from the book. There are bits and pieces from the book. And there could be passages from any book, from any magazine, from any newspapers. I really don't get why people automatically think I'm talking about the Bible. But what happens is people come in and they just see me with a book, and as I'm reading passages from it, analyzing them literally, like I'm not in a way that people would expect, but literary analysis is not just explaining what's being said in the book. Anybody can do that. Any group of middle-aged women who do a book club can read and talk about what they read. I'm actually using literary tools to bring literary analysis to an audience. So I talk about what kind of narrative it is. I talk about the protagonist. I talk about the activating circumstance if it's a short story. I talk about a variety of different literary figures of speech, literary figures, and things that you have to really know this stuff. You have to be like a teacher, or you have to be an academic. This is not things that people just pick up a book and know about. So it's very different. Teaching literature is very different from just reading a book out loud. Anybody that finishes first grade can pick up a book and read it out loud. So that's not what I'm doing. I feel that when people overly simplify what I do, I really don't want to have anything to do with them, because I already know that it's impossible to have a conversation with somebody like that who doesn't want to get the point of what I'm doing. So here we have a group of people that were doing drugs, and he mentioned Oslo S. Oslo S stands for Oslo Sentralstasjon, and it's the central station for the trains, the train station. And in that area in Oslo, that's where they sit and do drugs. So this group of people were doing drugs, and now William, the character that is sitting in a holding cell of some sort, he's talking about why he thinks he's in there. First, what happens in the interior monologues, if you will, call them that, when a character's talking to him or herself? That's a monologue. Dialogue is when there's two or more people having a conversation. A monologue is when a person's talking, apparently to themselves, but there is an audience for it. There is a play. I'm gonna check for the name of it. Okay, Adélia Prado, that's a writer that writes in Portuguese. Adélia Prado. She's a Brazilian writer and poet. She was born in Minas Gerais. That's where my brother actually lives, Minas Gerais. Okay, so she wrote this play. All right, she wrote some texts that originated the play Dona Doida, which is basically a one-woman show. The actress, Fernanda Montenegro, whom I had the pleasure of seeing performing Dona Doida, that's it. It's just a monologue, a series of interior monologues. I say interior monologues when I feel that the characters are talking to themselves. And when it's almost like you're thinking out loud, I call those interior monologues. The monologues can also just be a person just And one of the most famous monologues ever, and just if I start saying it, people already recognize it. Even the most ignorant person will know, to be or not to be. And that's a monologue from the play Hamlet. It is actually called a soliloquy. There is a difference between a soliloquy and a monologue. But I think for the purposes of explaining to an audience what one entails, what the other entails, I talk about their similarities first. And the similarity is that in both a soliloquy and a monologue, they're both, when you're talking, it's just one person talking. There is an audience, but the person doesn't really acknowledge the audience. It's a conversation with themselves. And some people like to say, and I don't like, for example, if you Google this, which I know that people do straight away if they're watching my show, I'm not saying everybody, but usually I get a lot of people that watch without signing in. And what they do is they Google stuff that I'm talking about. And I think that guy, Hanky Dude, he did that. I was talking about the play, I think, The Importance of Being Earnest. And then I went on to talk about the book, The Picture of Dorian Gray. And he was in here, he Googled this stuff. And then he started to type in things that were straight. I don't even think he was typing that stuff, but he was copying and pasting it straight into the chat box. And as soon as I Googled it, I found the exact thing that he was saying. I disagree with when you Google this, you're going to find a monologue is a long and typically tedious speech by one person during a conversation, while the soliloquy is the act of speaking one's thoughts aloud when by oneself or regardless of any hearers. So I don't know, somebody put this in there, but I don't trust everything that's written that you just Google, and I don't think people should either. I trust the knowledge coming from real books. Real books, and by real books, I don't mean like some girl from The Bachelor that went and published her experiences as a contestant. I'm not talking about what is her name again, Snooki from the Jersey Shore or whatever. I'm talking about knowledge that comes from books that are classic pieces of literature, and the knowledge that I acquired from going to university, from learning from serious sources. Unfortunately now, well, there is a fortunate side for having the internet and the tools for search engines and stuff. But there's also a disadvantage because anybody can publish whatever they want online. And some people are so naive sometimes that, oh, it's written, it's published, it must be true. And you have to filter. Just because something comes up at first doesn't mean that that's the most accurate explanation for anything. So I tell people to be very, very careful. At any rate, so I was talking about a soliloquy and a monologue. In his cell, the holding cell, where this guy was, William, first we have access to his inner thoughts. We have access to his inner thoughts about why is he there. He's trying to figure out, he's analyzing the cell, looking at the cell and trying to figure out, why am I here? Why was I brought here? What kind of cell is this? Why am I here? He's talking to himself. And then somebody comes in and he starts to ask questions because he wants to know why he's in there. So So now he gets an explanation. Du og kompisene dine har duppet vårt. Vi har lett hele uke og spurt på gata. Det mye selgere. Det du fengsel, for plutselig har du stor kar. Jeg trodde det ville ligge trygt under baken, men dere junkie har som rutter. Kommer til overalt. Dere som selger? Freddy flytte. Trodde du skulle prøve å nekte. Jeg bare tar inn på Oslo S. Hvor har du gjort av det? Ligger I leiligheten vår. Vi sitter på dassen. Det mye igjen, og vi har penger for det vi sølte. Skal gjøre opp for det vi har skutt. Du bør snakke sant. Husker du afrikaneren som du slås med I natt? Jeg husker ikke en dritt. Ikke en dritt. Jeg husker ikke en dritt. That's the same as saying, I don't remember shit. And that's an expression in Norwegian. He says, it means I don't remember shit. Jeg husker ikke en dritt. Det han som eier dope, og han la deg ikke slippe billig. Jeg ble straffet da stoffet forsvant. Så du kan tenke deg hva som kommer til å gjøre med deg. Billien presser seg tett opp på veggen for å puste raskere. Freddy kneppet opp skjorten, foldet det sammen og la plagget på gulvet. Så dro han opp remsene som strammet det skuddsikre vesten rundt midjen, men nå begynte han å åke seg. Under vesten hadde han en hvit trøye I stretch som satt tett mot den svette huden. Han dro armene ut og trøye armene, vrengte trøyen opp til halsen og snudde ryggen mot viljen. Jeg måtte stå med hendene mot veggen, så slå han med det jævle plastrøret sitt. So he had some sort of a, you know, when police officers and most security guards and whoever you find here in Norway doing security work or any sort of, they don't touch people when they don't hurt people, they don't carry guns. So I think it's a bit of a joke. I think that they should have something to defend themselves. So if somebody has a gun, they are at disadvantage. So, it's one of the things I never understood about the laws in Norway, that police officers cannot carry guns. I don't really get it, but oh well. So he's afraid of being hit with some plastic stick. He sees that somebody has a plastic stick and he's afraid of being hit with it. So some of the literary tools that were used so far in the narrative, there are parallel stories being told. There's a story of the family that's the affected party. And while we're on the subject, to affect are two different verbs. To affect someone means to have an effect on someone. To effect means to develop or put into effect a project or something of the sort. I see a lot of native speakers of English using the two words as if they were one. They're not the same thing. Maybe it's because of pronunciation, because people pronounce the two words as effect, so they don't really see the difference. I can't really for the life of me understand how, because to me it's different. I think that learning a language from the point of view of a foreign language, of a different language, I think you have the advantage of learning it a lot better than a native speaker. I've noticed this to be the case with everybody that I have ever taught. Even with Portuguese, they have a better understanding of the language than a lot of native speakers of Portuguese. Usually when people teach the language that is their first language, they know more about that language than people who just speak it. They don't have any academic preparation. So here we have a dialogue now between the people whom he took all the drugs from, and he's telling them, maybe he's bluffing, that the drugs are in the apartment. Maybe he's just trying to buy some time. Máquina vai passante meter breda os trakte sig fra skuldeblad til skuldeblad. Viljen telte syv avtrykk etter røret. Han kalte det a lesson. Det vil nok være få en bare lesson enn meg. Viljen gjenvant kontrollen over anberettet. Gjenvant. You have the verb in Norwegian, å vinne. Å vinne, vant, vunnet. And then you have the word igjen, which means again. So to win again. Of course, like when people want to translate things literally and they just want to look at the word and what the word means, they pick up a dictionary and you just look at the meanings that we see there and they want to make it work with what is written in the dictionary. But you have to sort of think outside the box and think about contextualizing the words that you find. So when you have yen vi ne, to take back control. That would be the best way to talk about something, when you regain control or to take back control, not to win control again. That doesn't make any sense. It doesn't sound natural if you translate it this way into English, although you're matching word for word the meanings of each and every word. It doesn't work linguistically. Plutselig kom en statisk skuring fra hoften til Freddy. Ja, hva da? Freddy drog opp en sambandsenhet fra utstyrsbeltet og holdt inn I talleknappen. Ja, en slask har gått inn på toalettet med mezzaninen, sikkert få sett deg sprøyte. Mottatt, jeg kom over en junkie som sitter I gangetunnelen. Ta det når jeg ferdig. Ikke noe hast, bare narkiser som bruker dassene der oppe uansett. Freddy trakk seg stretchtrøyen og kledde på seg vesten og skjorten. Så dro han opp en mobil fra lommen og tastet et telefonnummer. Hvor røtter deres ligger? Some books are divided into chapters, and some chapters have titles. And you know that they're going from one part of the story to another, because there is a number on top plus a chapter title. Not every book is divided that way. This particular book here, the chapters are subdivided into parallel stories. So when there is a shift from one story to the next, there are three asterisks on top that signify the shift in the narrative from one parallel story to the next.